बस
बस
हेलो, हाँ, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस योर
यस सर
ओके, गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. होप ऑल आर वेल टिल नाउ, एंड वी होप एवरीबडी अमंगस्ट एंड ऑल कम्युनिटी रिमेन्स हेल्दी इन दिस पैंडेमिक. प्लीज टेक केयर ऑफ योर सेल्फ एंड ऑल अदर्स. We now continue with our web series. Last week we had taken a break. We had done a workshop on color Doppler. This week we have got two different and unique topics. First is the CHIC or oral cavity ultrasound by Dr. S. K. Joshi. Most of you know him. He is a very senior radiologist or academician from our region. And he has got more than 40 years of teaching experience, and he has got very unique topics. Last time we had heard about ultrasound techniques in a very simple way, and this is one of his what you can say USP, at oral cavity or CHIC ultrasound. And I think this would be useful for many of us in understanding the anatomy and which can be evaluated by ultrasound. The second lecture is by Dr. Kalpana Bhatmadi. She is from Mumbai, and she practices exclusive skin ultrasound. And I think it's a unique what you can say unique technique to study skin in detail, and it's quite useful in a day-to-day practice for dermatologists. So the equipment may be specialized, but the technique is very useful, and we should, as a radiologist, we should take up that technique as well. So I would request Dr. Joshi sir to start his lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Prakash, Prashant. Oh, good evening, friends. This is the third time I'm meeting you. Hope all of you are keeping good health away from Corona. Today it is a very unique topic. I hope I'm audible to all of you. Hello? Hello?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, sir, you are audible. Madam, you can just turn off your video.
Oh yeah.
I call today, the topic is little different. And when I say ultrasound of the cheek, initially many people started wondering, what is this you are doing? Why do you need ultrasound cheek when I can see so many things there? But somehow I was not happy. One day I was sitting with my ultrasound machine, and it was a linear probe. I didn't have any patients in front. I'll use the word playing with my ultrasound probe. And I was just trying to put it on my cheek, which, of course, jelly was. And there I could reveal myself, huge world of information going through my own cheek. Then the interest started. We are lucky enough to have association with our sister institute, SDM Dental College, which has got its own oromaxillofacial surgery unit, separate, a 50-bedded hospital there attached to dental college, having its own full-time anesthetist, pediatrician, and of course maxillofacial surgeons and plastic surgeons. So I get referrals from there, having gone initially studied, and then after having defined the various methods and information. So one of the PG, I asked her, how do you inject, how do you know that you are injected a local anesthesia into submucosa? Sir, we inject, sir, routinely. So bring one patient, let me see where you inject. When she completed injection, I told her, you are not in the submucosa, far deeper to that, or not knowing the rest of the layers. Then it made me an additional interest to tie up with the anatomy department, take cadaveric sections at various levels, both in coronal and axial, do live sonography at different levels of the same, which cuts have been taken, define the sonographic anatomy, then we said we can go ahead with taking cases and trying to understand more about it through ultrasound tape. This is where the story started. With that background, this is, of course, this is our whole campus. These are all the boys' hostel, this is the playground, and this is the general hospital. This is the, again, hostels here. And that is the medical college and the ladies' hostel and the super specialty block. And this is our auditorium. On this side is our dental college. So this is our dental college here. This is dental college. And attached to that is our craniofacial unit. As I said, from here we get references. And from that day onwards, I went on wherever I used to get a chance in radiology or in dental conferences, try to increase the awareness of it and usefulness of it, and try to reduce unnecessary high cost investigation. But still, I'm not happy with my efforts of creating the awareness. Referrals continue to lack because we are lucky to have from our own focus areas of referral sources. We are getting more and more experiences and a lot of cases were done. And the cases have been already published, some of the cases through ultrasound tube. Now I'll deal with my talk into these groups. Gross cheek anatomy, floor of the mouth anatomy, defining HR-USG anatomy, maxillofacial region, and methodology of how to do these cheeks, ultrasound sonography, and then case presentation. A simple definition of cheek, you know, the fleshy side of the face below the eye and between the mouth and the eye. USG for cheek, many people ask, is it applicable? I say it is. Cheek structure is ideal for HR-USG evaluation. It is superficial, easily accessible, has very good tissue differences like skin, fat, muscles, gland, ducts, vessels, so many. All these structures were considered as one cheek, but the cheek has got so many components, which all of them do suffer during disease process, which can be easily evaluated with high resolution sonography. What structures of cheek and its neighbors can be identified by HR-USG? These are all the list. You can skin, subcutaneous plate, buccal pad of fat, buccinator, submucosa, mucosa, masseter and lateral relations, temporalis, arteries, and TM joint, not intraarticular, but periarticular, or swelling in the region of TM. And its neighbors like vestibule, gingiva, bucco, gingival sulcus, periodontal tissue, etc., tongue and lips, floor of the mouth, sublingual space, submandibular space, and parotid gland, I have excluded in this because many of us do parotid gland, but it also is a neighbor of the cheek, so I have just made a mention. Retromandibular space, yes, interdental space, alveolar margins, mental foramen, infraorbital foramen, external nose, arteries of the face, and various other facial planes and spaces all can be studied as its neighbors. Is it essential? If you are in a maxillofacial unit, the commonest problem is trismus. They can't open their mouth, and hence the clinical limitation. So when they can't open, you can't evaluate, and that's why the way diagnosis go on, and imaging based on that, they try to get it to the plain radiograph, CT, MRI. But there's a major limitation, the trismus, clinical limitation. And sometimes differentiating some of the mimicking lesions. So many differential diagnoses come. Extent of the lesion, inflammatory tumors, raging, etc. Inflammatory, for example, if there's a Ludwig's, whether the abscess is formed or just is still in the process of formation, it's clinically very difficult to make out, and they start putting the probe and all or needle. But ultrasound can help you to evaluate the stage of the inflammatory process. Limitations of plain radiography, all of us know. High cost imaging CT, MRI, and with inherent their own limitation. So ultrasound or the cheek, yes, it is essential. What information HR-USG cheek can provide? Anatomical details of various layers of the cheek, as I mentioned already. Detection and characterization of the lesion, including the vascularity, extent of the lesion and staging, lymph node evaluation. Now we'll go to cheek sonography, best initial screening modality, may conclude the diagnosis, may support the diagnosis, may suggest further imaging methods, non-invasive, of course, all of us know these advantages, no contraindications, cost-effective, easier follow studies, real-time information, and blood flow information. Convenient, comfortable, bedside, no radiation, all these are added inherent advantages. There are limitations. Now, medial to the ramus, the structures which are present cannot be studied in intact ramus. Through that, any structures which are medial to ramus cannot be studied. Intact bone information is not possible. TMJ intra-articular structures, not possible. Periarticular, it is possible, but not intra-articular. Post-operative scar tissue, lot of problems in differentiating. And similarly, in external large wound, very thick patient, muscles of face and nose, they cannot be studied. So I say that HRUSG or cheek is adjunct and does not entirely replace the other imaging modalities. Where all it can be used? Evaluation of clinical conditions like swollen cheek, maybe painful swollen cheek or a painless swollen cheek, maybe unilateral or bilateral. Limited mouth opening, non-traumatic. There are many conditions that patient cannot open his mouth. Painful chewing, swelling over face, maybe any of the regions like midline, parasagittal, floor of the mouth, TM joint region, submandibular region, nose, lip, gum, etc. Tongue lesions, lateral margin, anterior and lateral margins. Salivary glands are excluded. As I said, many of us do regular study, ultrasound study of the salivary glands. Identifiable lesions, yes, cheek, growth, meningioma, lymphangioma, cysts, oral submucous fibrosis, abscesses, discharging sinuses, and possible cause underlying. Masseter evaluation, including with contraction by making use of MO, benign hypertrophy of the masseters, space infection, trauma, masticatory space infection, that is superficial masticatory space, TMJ swelling, sometimes they come with a click or swelling in the TMJ region, lytic lesions of the jaw, gum evaluation, lip lesions, midline swellings, tumor staging, salivary glands, space infections, tongue, lymph node evaluation. Now we'll go to classical cheek anatomy, not in detail, but to have, this is how the coronal slice of the cadaveric slice of the cheek, the superior vestibule, inferior vestibule, all of this is the cheek, medial and lateral aspect. This is the axial slice, is how we study an ultrasound while we take axial slices and coronal slices. This is the region which we study in detail, almost 60 to 70, 70% more than that of these structures can be identified. Now, with the parotid gland, and this is anterior, this is the posterior, whole of the parotid gland, which can easily identify, all of us know, parotid duct emerging from here and going anterior border of the masseter, dipping down. Superficial temporal artery here, parotid, more than facial arteries can be seen, masseter can be seen. Now, these are the posterior artery and branches can be identified, extend carotid and internal maxillary artery going dipping down behind the mandible here, and transverse facial artery, superficial temporal artery, posterior biliary digastric, and still masseter is here. If the carotid is removed, but masseter is intact, facial artery can be seen. Buccal pad of fat is very vague, but to some extent we can study with the ultrasound. Now, sublingual space here, or submental space, I say, you can identify the anterior biliary digastric on both sides, and about here, about Milo head and the Geno head here. And these are the sublingual parotid ducts, which can be really identified. The sagittal section, this is how we can take the section submentally. The submentally, sagittal sections also can be taken with the fat, and you have a Milo head here. Geno head and Geno block. Our sound probe cannot go to this deep, so maximum we can cover up this area of information. So I will go into the details of the ultrasound anatomy of it. For convenient purpose, we divide this area which we studied now into two rectangles and three triangles. Posterior triangle, anterior two triangles, upper rectangle and lower rectangle. The corresponding anatomical structures can be studied. Just it gives us a careful looking into these anatomical structures without missing them. Here, this one is removed. That is, we have cut open the ramus. The structures medial to the ramus cannot be studied with ultrasound probe. That better studied with intraoral probe. But they have this trismus, so it is difficult to put the intraoral probe also in some of these cases. But these structures cannot be done or studied in detail. Now again, these are the upper rectangle, lower rectangle. The structures which now I conveyed you can be studied on ultrasound. Posterior triangle structures can be studied, including posterior digastric. Now we'll go into sonar anatomy itself. This is the original study done in a hospital. So these are the various levels of the cadaver. Accordingly, you can see all those layers are well defined and they can be appeared. This is the internal mucosa. Actually, it is not the mucosa, it is interfaced in the oral cavity and the mucosa, which appears as a dense line. This whole of it is a mirror image. So our study confined to this area. But though the study exists, I have shown you as per the cadaveric slice, but when you do ultrasound and evaluation, we put the slice in this way on the same layers which are better seen. This is the interface of mucosa and oral cavity, submucosa, buccinator, buccal pad of fat, and here is the masseter, is the ramus, and subcutaneous fat. This is the histology gross slide and the corresponding layers which you can see beautifully. Now, this is submucosa and hypoepiphone, the buccinator. And here, the normal thickness varies from 0.7 to 1.4 millimeters. So, in submucous fibrosis, it increases definitely. It is more than 2.5 millimeters here, and as compared to normal and 1.3 millimeters. Submucous fibrosis. And this is a normal one. This is a mirror image, not to look into that. The corresponding histological slice, you can see submucous fibrosis, a normal one compared to that. Now, we'll see which of the imaging method or methodology can give these anatomical details. This is a cadaveric slice, this is a CT slice, this is MRI, and this is ultrasound. Undoubtedly, ultrasound is giving you good amount of information about the cheek compared to any of the imaging modalities. Same one, put it into regular study what we do. Now, axial slices, these are all published one and these are all our own images I have taken from my own study. These are the various layers. And the axial slices at the lower portion here, you can see the reference point at angle of the mouth. And these are the various layers, including the masseter, ramus, and the parotid gland, and all those layers. This is a mirror image of that. Coronal slices also in the same way. This is the anterior coronal slice, and the cadaveric ultrasound correspond. This is the mid one. So all these study was done originally in our own institute and then defined, which has given us a good confidence in evaluating the lesions of the cheek and its neighbors. That is the internal maxillary artery going there. So all these can be identified on ultrasound. The technique, yes, we have devised our own methods. You also can devise your own methods. So close open mouth, just open mouth without any altering the cheek status. Cheek blow technique, tongue touch technique, fruit jelly technique, masseter at rest and at lunch space with M mode. Slices were taken axial, sagittal, and coronal, and of course, panoramic is also included in that. So, probes of 7 to 12 megahertz and panoramic extended scan, various names are there for that, and of course, Doppler. Translucent position, this is for all the axial slices at various levels. retromandibular, retromandibular, retroauricular region, and the coronal slices, submental and alveolar marches. It's these slices open mouth, which I already shown you this slice. This is how the whole anatomy looks into. This is a blown out cheek. You remember the previous and compare it with the blown out cheek. The layers are better defined. It stretches out and it becomes a little more easier for to evaluate some of the lesions, not all, but it's better to study combined, both flat and also blown out cheek. This is a mirror image. Tongue touch technique. We ask the patient to put the tongue tip to the area of his symptoms. It becomes easier. If it's a small lesion, you can't go on searching for it. So he touches the tongue from one side, and there we look into the. This is how the, this is the tip of the tongue, and these are all various layers of the cheek. And these are better seen here. These are all the muscles, and this is the central graph. So you can easily identify whole of the tongue anterior portion. And this is the technique how it goes. There is a video for this. One minute. Okay, I missed the video here. Okay, I missed the video. I'll try to show you later. So these are the various layers which can study, including the anterior margin of the tongue and also underlying portion of the tongue in detail. This is the anterior tongue touch technique, and this is lateral tongue touch. Now, panoramic view, you can see beautifully the anterior, posterior, parotid gland, whole of the masseter, buccinator here, and various layers of the cheek here, at this angle of the mouth itself. This is lower rectangle, again, superficial lobe, the parotid, masseter, and rest of the layers here. The upper rectangle, parotid duct. It takes time for us to identify it there. Yeah? Sometimes you see fine microbubbles moving there, or you can see the movement of the fluid. Sublingual, the floor of the mouth, you can see the position where you can keep. And these are antibiliary of digastric, genohyoid, and these are the sublingual salivary gland. The mylohyoid goes through and through. These are whatever structures are shown, they can be seen. Retromandibular paired vessels can be studied very well, and deep lobe to some extent, not whole of it. Here you can see those vessels. This is a deep lobe, some portion of it. Alveolus evaluation, put the probe at the alveolar margin, and whole of this can be especially entered into space, the gum in that region, alveolar margin. Soft tissue alveolar margin. Evaluation of gingivobuccal sulcus vestibule. This is the medial limit of the lateral limit of the cheek. There is a gum here and here also. There is a space vestibule, superior and the inferior. So routine ultrasound, it abuts the medial portion limit of this and difficult to evaluate. So we have devised this area to be studied. If you ask the patient to blow, no doubt will be filled with air and you can't study these lesions. So we try to intervene with the fruit jelly here. It will remain in that space. You ask the patient, he's very happy to keep it there, and it distends and beautiful, all the layers can be seen. This is how the fruit jelly is interposed. These are the lateral layers in the superior vestibule and the inferior vestibule. So this is a coronal slice with the fruit jelly distending the vestibule. Now this is a panoramic axial slices. This is parotid, masseter, and distended vestibule. And layers can be seen better. So these are same similar slices at various levels. So you can easily identify the lesion is superior vestibule and inferior vestibule. Also sometimes there are invasive lesions which are partly involving both of them, a limited vestibule opening. This is again our own image which was put into publication. Superior vestibule, inferior vestibule. This is the gum margin here. And this is the lateral, the medial wall of the cheek and all these layers. Masseter, clench and M mode, we study it in a relaxed phase and in clenching phase and see it's some of the lesions become prominent when it is clenched. So it is part of the study, better to do relaxed phase and clench phase. Relax and here when you clench it, we apply M mode. The deflection of what it represents the strength of the masseter. I don't put any major unit. But if it is a weaker one, the deflection of the M mode will be less. This will be useful sometimes in some of the post-operative cases to evaluate the strength of the masseter. Now we'll go to some of the cases which we have done in our institute. So these are some of the presented cases. Painful cheek with swelling, painful cheek without swelling, painless cheek swelling, painful chewing, click in TMJ while chewing, non-healing oral ulcers, restricted mouth opening, proven malignancies, non-specific including neighbors, some of the conditions. This patient in the having the left lower cheek, swelling was there, pain and swelling. But the only pain was there since 1 month, swelling and restricted mouth opening since 2 days only. This is how the swelling appeared. This is our probe. These are the coronal slices in the temporal region, and also we took similar cases in the cheek region also. And of course, axial also we took in both the condition, both the areas. So this is, you can see beautifully whole length of the masseter, and the submasseteric collection is there, and this is the ramus. So we can conclude there's a collection. And it is inflammatory. This is a long section axial. This is a coronal section. It is axial, you can see. This is the coronal one. And the submasseteric collection. This is a normal masseter. I mean, it's pushed up. It is not invaded. It is deep to that masseter. Now, this superficial temporal, that is the temporalis muscle. This is the temporal muscle which is pushed away. But the same infections have spread into the deeper to the temporalis muscle. And this is deep to the, here you can see this is the axial, this is the coronal, and this core of the temporalis muscle is elevated. So this is an abscess. You have come to know what is it, at what layer it has involved. And this whole of this, you can say panoramically from superficial temporal to, you can say masseteric region in between the zygomatic. So this is a sagittal section in the temporomandibular region, till that whole of the cheek. Another case, a diabetic male, 54 years, painful left cheek. You can see similar collection, superficial to masseter. This is a transfer, this is axial. In all these cases, history is only a painful swell. And here is abscess. I could see bubbles in a real time one. And wherever granulation tissue, you can see some of these. High flow state. Now drain was put, and after the drain is a post-operative. Later you can follow up the patient easily and see obliteration of the abscess. Soft nodular swelling since 2 months. The soft nodular swelling in the right cheek. And this is the space which is involved. Ultrasound wise, you can see a well-defined area. Okay, I'll show you, I missed copying whole of it. So you can see fine speckles, air bubbles moving there. So that was an abscess, but a chronic abscess. Another patient with the swelling, and you can see similar swelling, again with a thicker wall. And then the communication to the next portion in a different space, and apply Doppler in the granulation tissue surrounding or hyperemic space. And these are all infected abscess destroyed areas, and this is the hyperemic granulation tissues. It was an abscess, again, chronic abscess. Retention cysts are common and contain nothing but uniformly distributed thick fluid like aggregate. Painless swelling, prominent left cheek. The complaint was my left cheek is more prominent than the right. So this is the right masseter, and this is the masseter on the left side. Over the masseter, you can see some portion of the parotid gland. And this whole of it is completely spreading, adding to the prominence of the cheek. It's in that innocuous, but patient was worried. This is all a normal one extension, but here it is throat is extending and more thick also, adding to the thickness of the cheek. And patient's worry was removed. Nothing else but overlapping portion of the parotid gland. Painless swollen left cheek, as you can see, with a surgical coronal section taken in the masseteric region. There's an intramasseteric benign condition with, you can see, dense echoic strands. It is nothing but intramasseteric lipoma. There's a well-defined wall also. Young lady worried about incidentally palpable nodule in the left cheek. So she was worried about the nodule, very difficult to clinically palpate. And what we can see is there is some well-defined area anterior to the parotid, superficial to the masseter, for the benign, simple nodule. Again, consoled her not to be worried upon. And she came for follow-up for simple fibroma. Palpable nodule clinically in the right cheek. They could not make out the intra or extramasseteric. You can see whole of the masseter and intramasseteric is a calcified nodule. So we can say it is something a calcified old lesion like hematoma, I could give it, because it doesn't have a specific wall all around. And this is normal portion of the masseter. When we carefully went into the cause for this, so there was a defect, a microfracture of 2 millimeter to 3 millimeter. History of old trauma was there. That was the cause for a hematoma and hence later coming out with a nodule like calcified area. So patient has symptoms, we have found out the cause and the reason for that, in that case, a post-traumatic hematoma. A painless swelling right cheek, you can see well defined. We can see a dense lesion with the acoustic shadowing, like a phlebolithic and one more here. So it was nothing but a masseteric hematoma. We have put it and it is beautifully. Same case, it could be easily diagnosed. Referred as painless swollen left cheek. Painless left cheek. This is a normal masseter, right? This is a swollen masseter, measurements are given. So this is thicker than left. A benign hypertrophy of the left masseter. Again, common, not very common condition, but when the referrals are there, you'll find it. Selective cases are referred. So one of the differential diagnoses for painless swollen cheek left side, that is benign hypertrophy of the masseter. This is a normal one. This is the left side, transverse end. It's thicker than that. Non-tender nodule, beautiful layers, you can see all of them. This was in the masseter. You can see masseter is opened up here. So we could give it as a benign a connective tissue tumor, intramasseteric, and it came out as a neurofibroma. What I'm trying to tell you is the beautiful anatomy and its location, its relation to the masseter, intra, extra, and possible benignity or otherwise. 2 years male, a history of swelling right mandible and retromandibular region, no fever and no pain. This is the swelling. For that, initially they did they do OPG, and they could see destroyed mandible. They thought it is an osteomyelitis. But externally, there were no any discharging sinus and all. CT was done, and again, that also showed the osteomyelitis. None of them could give the cause for osteomyelitis. I just, with interest, they referred it for ultrasound because awareness has already created. Surprisingly, I could see a well-defined, hyper-echoic, long-dated structure scattered in that. surrounded by hypoechoic area, and they're classical of fungal colony or fungal infection. And accordingly, the patient was treated. It was a fungal osteomyelitis, and this is a surrounding granulation tissue, which you see as hypoechoic area. So later, I referred the book, and our Madhura foot and all, ultrasound-wise, similar appearance will be there. After treatment, of course, you can see the smile on his face compared to initial. Here, bilateral painless swollen cheek, 7 to 8 years. So naturally, there are multiple cystic lesions. And the first time I saw this case, on the other side also, both right and the left side also, bilateral cystic lesions. I naturally use the word polycystic, but I never heard before that. And I went through the literature, the polycystic disease of the carotid glands is known. So I gave a diagnosis of polycystic disease of carotid glands. Another case, a painless one again, a cystic lesions with fluid-like movement inside. A phlebolysis are seen. So it was again a case of hemangioma. Painful cheek. This 70-year-old male complains of painful nodule and pain over the face. All over the place, painful tenderness, a specified area. I just went to him and I, let me see where is it painful. He says, don't touch, sir. I will show you. If pinpointed, this is the point of tenderness. When I put my probe there, and there was a hypoechoic well-defined area. I put color doctor there, as the artery, you can see superficial temporal artery. And there is surrounding the hypoechoic area, a classical of superficial artery. Another case, a 28 years here, similar complaint like tender nodule, very tender nodule, and that was here, anterior to the masseter, superficial to masseter, and superior to masseter. And again, similar, and on artery, and surrounded by this hypoechoic area, classical of arthritis. No swelling, no tenderness, but had only pain while chewing, only pain while chewing. That too recently, for last a month or so. I can see a calculus here in the mouth of the parotid duct, measuring about 1.7 into 2 millimeters, which is difficult to pick up by routine imaging methods. You can see surrounding edema here, and this patient was getting pain while doing chewing. So we can detect some of the causes for such complaints. This is what it is. 19 years female click sound and pain during mouth opening. Whenever she opens, she used to get a click. So this is the condyle, the whole of the ramus, the masseter here, the joint space here. This is the normal joint space, 0.02. And here the slightly increased. And just screening through the periarticular region, I could see small hypoechoic area. Went on following that, it went on increasing in size, and ultimately I could get a shoe-shaped structure like that. This patient did not undergo any surgery, so I could not come to the final diagnosis. Possibility I gave was it excluded this. We couldn't prove anything. But ultrasound has helped you to give the cause for a click and during the opening the mouth. 30-year female presented with swelling over the left pre-auricular region since 1 year. Again, there was only swelling over there, and this joint space is grossly widened. So thick fluid in the initial portion, then careful screening again, ultrasound-wise, up to the small hyperechoic elements inside that thick fluid. It was in the joint space, ultrasound-wise. They sent the patient for MRI, and they said it is joint effusion there with debris. This is what the MRI report. Ganglions, this effusion and multiple small debris are seen in the left temporomandibular joint. Ganglions. So we gave, because of the presence of these hyperechoic element inside a joint space, which is the cartilaginous portion, so we gave possibility of synovial chondromatosis. And they underwent surgery. They could remove all these calcified elements from there. So it was a case of synovial chondromatosis. restricted mouth opening, there are many causes, and commonest here in our part, of course, in Maharashtra also, submucous fibrosis. So the submucosa normally, I told you, 0.7 to 1.4 millimeters in the submucous fibrosis little thickening. And you can, the normal one, this is the abnormal one. He cannot open, very restricted move with the mouth opening. And you can see, this is a hyper-thickened area of submucous fibrosis. There I showed you little hyperechoic submucous fibrosis. We are still to study various stages of submucous fibrosis with histological correlation. So this is also submucous fibrosis. And definitely it is 3 millimeter thick. And we can distribute and draw on a mapping of the submucous fibrosis. Now surgical procedures are available, corrective procedure, and the mouth opening has been shown to improve about more than 3 to 4 fingers. So it might help surgeon to decide what are all the areas of need to be tackled for submucous fibrosis. Now this patient was referred as known case of submucous fibrosis, but had extra orocutaneous draining, orocutaneous draining signs. So our idea was not to diagnose submucous fibrosis, but to define the area of submucous and cause for this, what you call this signs, draining. Now this is submucous fibrosis, grossly thickened here. This is another area, and this was the site of orocutaneous fissure. And of course, lymph nodes could be evaluated. More than that, I could see a stump which is left behind after extraction. That was the focus of infection which has led to a submucous fibrosis, in that case, an orocutaneous fissure. So already having submucous fibrosis, and there is a stump left, a source of infection, and also resulting in having a orocutaneous fissure. Oral submucous fibrosis, this is ultrasound has given all four components of the disease process: oral submucous fibrosis, orocutaneous fissure, then reactive lymph node enlargement, and residual stump, possible source of infection in that. It was a keloid after some surgery, non-healing. It was internally, there were some ulcers. So we could see in hypoechoic area, deep to masseter, and loss of all the soft tissue planes here, the inflammatory process. But we could not define how far it extends in the vestibule. So we gave a food jelly technique. So we could see only this is the area showing the collection, not extending all these areas. So that was quantified, and ultrasound this one, it was drained. Proven malignancy, early cases of squamous cell carcinoma. Now recent trends are showing that tumor depth is more important in predicting the prognosis of the oral squamous cell carcinoma. He has said that better survival rates in patients with tumor thickness less than 6 millimeter than those greater than 6 millimeter. So next he added, they propose that tumor thickness be included in evaluation of prognosis, planning, and therapy, and comparing results in cases of squamous cell carcinoma or buccal mucosa. But who has to measure the exact measurement up to 3 to 4 millimeters, 5 to 6 millimeters, ultrasound is the best way. I'm talking of early cases. Recommended that this another study, they recommended that infiltration depth of 4 millimeter to be used as an absolute indication for performing neck dissection, otherwise simple dissection. Now you can see the hypoechoic area as is already proven cases. I'm talking only proven cases and nothing to say it is malignancy, non-malignancy. A suspected malignancy has got a mediolateral thickness of 5.3 millimeter. Does not involve adjacent structure. Now, same one under the CT, you can't differentiate the tumor and adjacent tail, all look alike. But here, at least, you can differentiate the adjacent tissue and the suspected pathology. So, we compared it to histopathological thickness also, and it was comparable in that case. Now this was the growth, 4.5 millimeter. Only HRUSG can measure them. Early superficial growth demonstrated by tongue touch technique. 60-year male with superficial mucosal lesion seen on clinical examination. Tongue touch technique demonstrating a growth of approximately 2.5 millimeter involving predominantly the mucosa and submucosa. Tongue margin is clear. Here are the lesion in the mucosa and in the tongue without tongue touch technique. And here you can see the tongue touch technique. The growth is here and normal tongue margins are here. So you can measure accurately the thickness of the growth which was clinically suspected. Clinically, you can see the outer margin, the ulcerated area, but thickness is very difficult to measure. 55-year-old with irritating non-healing ulcer. This was the first ultrasound I did then, somewhere in 2000, almost 2000, so many years back, and I was thrilled to see the ulcerated area, also the extent of the lesion, the normal continuous mucosa, and the ulcerated area. This was squamous cell carcinoma, the first case which could identify and also layer by layer to be detected. It was a very simple old machine 20 years back, a Samsung machine. Sorry, it was about 20 years back, I didn't have a machine. Early carcinoma demonstrated by fruit jelly technique. Now this is the malignancy here. And when you interpose jelly, this is what you can see. You can define that margin. If the jelly is not there, the thickness with that and also of the gum, you can't really evaluate what is the thickness of the tumor. So again, the same problem with the MRI also, you can't identify exact growth and the adjacent edematous soft tissue and all. This is jelly here, no doubt, but all look alike and exact measurement you could not make. This was another case of the growth and the superior vestibule and the inferior vestibule. You can't come to know to what extent it is involved in the structure. New fruit jelly, the well-defined inferior vestibule is absolutely clear, not involving, whereas it is purely involving still half the vestibule. This is what on CT it appears. This patient had a pain in the left side of the cheek since 4 to 5 months. He had ankylosis also. So this was what colitis and some ulcerations here. And an ultrasound, you can see minimal erosions of the alveolar margins here, which can be identified with ultrasound. Vestibule tumor extension you can make out in another case. So superior vestibule involved, inferior vestibule involved. Submacetic spread can be easily identified. Tumor submacetic spread, you can easily detect. Tumor has spread in deep to the macetum. And also lymph node evaluations are superior here. Perivascular spread, pericarotid sheath involvement can be identified. So tumor spread evaluation. Whenever tumor suspected, we do grid like this and take all these slices and give them approximate extension of the lesion. Where all areas, to what extent is involved in thickness at various levels. They look almost like MRI slices or CT slices. This is how the distribution, quantification, or of course qualification and the topographical extent of the lesion can be identified. So alveolar carcinoma, again, unless it is a very thin slices, cortical margin very difficult to be evaluated for destruction. But here you can see the cortical margin is destroyed with the underlying growth. So another case, it's already proven, a malignant looking clinically also malignancy. Ultrasound wise, this is a normal submental area. And I showed you the normal anatomical structures earlier. And in this case, you can identify all of this distorted, only the right left side antebelly of digastric area. But all this right is compressed, all nodular big masses, destroying the anatomy in the floor of the mouth. And there are extensive lymph node involvement, including the parotid, intraglandular parotid lymph nodes also. CT, subplane radiograph, all detailed studies were done, pulmonary metastasis seen. It was a case of melanoma. Looking clinically also, it has a blackish color, you can see. A tongue lesion, anterior half of the peripheral tongue lesions, HRS is very useful and is comparable to MRI. For any given case of tongue lesion, MRI is always superior to HRS. I've shown you the normal anatomy. Now you can see the lateral margin of the tongue is involved. And what you can see added ultrasound wise, medial extension is not, is confined only to some portion of the tongue, but not crossing the midline. So this is what you can tell about the growth in the lateral aspect and anterior aspect. Of course, lymph node evaluation can be perfectly done. A CT, MRI was also done. This is a huge ulceration, and same thing, an MRI. Here also we're not crossing the midline, here also not crossing the midline. Another case, excavating type of ulcer, that is CA tongue. And again, you can see on MRI. I don't say definitely, I don't claim ultrasound as the prime modality, but definitely in initial cases, it helps for to evaluate at least to crossing the midline or not. A lymph node evaluation definitely ultrasound. All these are all the CA tongue with the lymph node evaluation. Miscellaneous and cheap neighbors. This patient, this is a normal infraorbital foramen. And this is widened infraorbital foramen in the same patient on left side. See, whenever the bony foramen are widened in the cranial region, we think of the contents and hence we think of the pathology which are added to the widening of this. So contents from this, either a nerve or a vessel. So accordingly, because the well-defined wall and all, I gave the possible diagnosis for neurofibroma. Patient underwent surgery. And it came out as a fungal granuloma, which I could never think. But here the carry home message is, it is possible to evaluate infraorbital phenomena and its status and its content. And recently they have mentioned about in case of facial trauma, distortion of this indicates some amount of adjacent fractures, which can be better seen, no doubt, in 3D, CT and all. Just the information wise. It has a play in trauma also. Submental region. 30 years female history of mild pain, submental region. Is a normal anatomy, submental region. And you can see the one cystic lesion I could see in the digastric belt. Just I moved my probe, I could see again one more adding to that. So I concluded that I and even there later also I could not come to know some cystic lesions, some not debris truly, so mildly tender. So I say it could be a lymph node evaluation, lymph node enlargement. And I asked her to come after 10 days of treatment, they disappear. So this is all some of the clinically vague complaints. We can define them, give a chance of pointing out the diagnosis. A diabetic toothache followed by painful swelling below the chin. So the normal anatomy in that region. All the planes are distorted. All the planes are edematous, especially superficial planes are all edematous. Same thing in sagittal section, this is the symphysis menti, and as you come down here, and all those planes are grossly distended and planes are lost. Softer thickness and tender. So this was the Ludwig's, no doubt. But what, so clinically also they can diagnose Ludwig's, but it is not ripened. The abscess is not formed. You can say evolving. You can wait for it to be at least ripened rather than putting the needle or plan for natural drainage for negative drainage. So this will definitely help to stage inflammatory condition also. Of course, associated lymph node enlargement. Gum evaluation is also possible. I will not go into the details of the gum. Whenever thickened gum comes, the dentist used to put a probe and see the thickness of it and also content of it, whether pus is there or the otherwise non-infective one. So these are all the layers of the gum. I will not go into the details of that. The anatomy of the layers of the gum. which have got corresponding definite anatomical structures. This is a case of Tippingham, and you can see the same patient having the non-infective inflammatory condition. Is normal one, abnormal, normal, abnormal. Lip also can be studied, especially muscle belly, which is required for while planning the cleft surgery. And they want to know what is the component of the muscle belly. It is not yet applied anywhere, but this information can be given. These are the lips with various layers, including the muscle. We take both axial and this is where you can see the probe, sagittal, you can say sagittal section, superior lip, inferior lip, definitely inferior thicker. And these are all hypoechoic, the muscle belly in that. So some of the conditions, these are normal muscle bellies in that. Some of the abnormal conditions we can diagnose, a thickened one. So here it is the submucosal layer, and the tongue is not touching that. And if touching, you can better beautifully see all those layers, still better. So anatomy of the layers can be better defined. And this is the left half of the lip, that is the normal left lip, normal left. And this is the abnormal right, the upper lip I'm talking. It was abnormal here, left was normal. Same, the normal flow in the labial artery, remember that triangle which I've shown you, anterior triangle. And on the right side, you can see very high velocity flow with low resistance, it was an angioma. All the layers of the cheek, so the lips are distorted. So the granulomatous cheilitis, which is not very common, but you can see the inflammatory process with loss of all the layers of tissue. The radicular cyst, ultrasound has a role to some extent. When the radicular cyst is more than 4 millimeter, you get a window like that. Through the window, ultrasound wise, you can see whether the contents are pus or some amount of granulation tissue is there. If some amount of granulation tissue is there, they will allow it to heal. They may not excavate it completely. So this is how it might help them in deciding what to do. They may not, in one case, they have to take a flap, another, they need not take it. So these are various cases of radicular cyst where ultrasound has a role. Now, CA maxilla, you know, ultrasound is not primary diagnosis. Wherever the bony defect or the destruction, we can evaluate the content of it and the vasculature of it. And same case, all these are CA maxilla. Now, in case of operative, post-operative cases, they do these corrective surgeries for mandible. So whenever they reset and they bring the lower portion up anteriorly, so this is the gap. They want to know, they keep on following this. They keep a distractor there and they keep on adjusting the height. So this distraction will keep on, the bony gap should be filled up by healthy bone. For that, the gap is studied. It starts filling up from base. And this evaluation can be done with ultrasound in that gap region of bone healing in a gap or a corrective surgery for the mandible. Now here, this is normal filling up. There's a cyst which is involved or interposed between the gap, so they may have to drain the cyst. Here, the infection of the gap, so they may have to tackle accordingly. Clinically, bony hard swelling in the nose. They are worried, and they could say it is not a bony hard, it is just a fibroma. Some surprise, it is the last case. So this patient, the 35 male, alcoholic, behavioral changes, refer from psychiatric ward, and for a small nodule in the left cheek. I could see a nodule in the parotid gland. By altering the echoes, gains, I could see internally some of the elements, so diagnosis very clear. But I went on seeing other side of the parotid, there also it was there. I went to see the thyroid also, it was there, so it was nothing but, you can see. So diagnosis very clear, cysticercosis spread all over. To summarize, HRUSG is convenient method of imaging for cheek and other facial structures having high potential if properly used. Further developments for the application of this method needs increasing awareness, close interaction for better understanding between the radiologist, craniofacial and plastic surgeon, with common view of providing best possible care to the patient at most affordable cost. Otherwise, till now, whatever dealt with all these cases, they are referred either for CT or MRI, bypassing much informative investigation thereafter. To my junior colleagues who are sitting there anywhere, recognize and respect the capability of available technology. Broaden the horizon of thinking and feel free to think. Feel the need of improvisation every day and never you feel perfect and complete. Break the tradition for better. Innovate and add to the treasure of knowledge, not at the cost of the patient. Never ever forget, patient is more important. I think some of you might be knowing, a small child was asking father, Daddy, have you seen a star in the apple? He was not very serious. How can there be a star in the apple? Daddy, I will show you, come. Oh, let me satisfy my son. He went along with him. And his son says, it is there, I'll show you, come. He went and he cut the apple, not in a traditional way, but in a non-traditional way, and demonstrated the hidden treasure of star in an apple, which father had never seen. Break the tradition and enjoy the hidden treasure. Thank you very much for patient listening.
Beautiful demonstration of various legions of chick and surrounding. Really, as you have said, ultrasound can kiss the tongue also by the newer machines with good resolution and your use of panoramic views almost many places. It was really a nice presentation. Sir, a few of the participants, I think they have joined late and they wanted to know, explaining the layers of the cheek ultrasound anatomy. If we can go back to that particular one or two slides, it would be useful.
Yeah. Okay, I will take this opportunity
right, sir,
to show those videos also, completely copying the folder rather than only the PPT.
Right.
Just give me one.
From this time, we have added a feedback link, and after completion of lecture, before you leave, all are requested to give the feedback, because feedbacks are very important for any work or any lecture, and it is full for the speakers also to improve and what the listeners want. So all of you are requested, whenever our both lectures are over, please fill up the feedback form.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant, for having added the feedback form.
Yeah, thank you, sir. It was your suggestion, and I think it would be useful for all.
It may not be possible immediately for them to have questions, and
So till then, I have one or two questions.
Yes, please.
You had shown one or two PM joint abnormalities.
Yeah.
What do you have any experience about use of ultrasound in PM joint dislocations as such? Because a long time I had seen one or two articles almost 20 years back, but after MRI, definitely MRI is definitely better than
your idea. TM joint, intra-articular derangement is there, so ultrasound is not good for intra-articular derangement.
Right,
definitely, as you said, MRI, both closed mouth and open mouth.
Open mouth, they do. One more question, sir. In case of ulcer on the tongue, as you said, half of the tongue we can see by touching the cheek.
Yeah.
If it is a biopsy negative ulcer, then I think ultrasound would be useful in delineating it better.
You're right. It can tell the depth of these, because you know tongue is the one where you will never come to the medial extension of any peripheral lesion.
Right.
Ultrasound, when it shows whole of the tongue and medial extension,
right,
that's what it adds to the clinical finding.
Yes.
I'll come back to that layers of the cheek.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe not my view. So this is lateral, this is medial, this is anterior, this is posterior. This is the axial slice. This is the masseter, this is the ramus, which you can easily identify in any of the axial slice of cheek. Now the medial most margin is very hyperechoic. We call it as mucosa, but actually it is not mucosa. It is an interface between oral cavity and mucosa. And just below that, whatever you see is the submucosa, which is hyperechoic. Slightly hyperechoic.
I think, sir, you need to full screen that probably. Not seeing.
Not seeing? It is full screen only. Okay. I have to magnify it. Okay.
This. The screen is not shared. We are just seeing the folders on your.
Sorry.
Can you see PPT now?
Now we are seeing the all the slides together. Yeah. Yes, sir. Now it is.
This is the axial slice exactly like this of the cheek region. This what you see is this is anterior, this is posterior, this is the lateral, that is the cheek surface and the medial margin.
Okay.
The ramus can be easily identified in any of the axial slices. Then in front of it, you can easily identify masseter. This I'm talking of axial slice.
Hmm.
Now the medial most margin is hyperechoic. It is mucosa, we call it, but it is not true mucosa. It is an interface between oral cavity and the mucosa, which is hyperechoic. Just deeper to that is little grayish one is the submucosa, and just deeper to that is hypoechoic, the buccinator muscle, and then comes the buccal pad of fat, and then of course skin and subcutaneous fat. This is the masseter, and this is the ramus. I think here they are still better saying mucosa and oral cavity interface, submucosa and hypoechoic is the buccinator. And of course, buccal pad of fat here. This, you can see those layers still better. I think I have cleared the clear anatomy of that.
Yeah.
It was thickened here, submucosa. But remember, the submucous fibrosis, depending at what stage of submucous fibrosis, the echogenicity varies, which we have not yet studied and we don't know it. Somewhere it's hyperechoic, somewhere it's hypoechoic.
Okay. Is it that, sir, in early stages it is hypo and then becomes hyper echoic?
I'm sorry, I have not followed those cases.
Okay, but you must be getting a lot of cases, sir, because that is quite common in our part also.
Oh, and nowadays because surgery is there,
right?
And they are treatable, that initial hopeless status has gone. There is some hope of improving them. So this anatomy will help surgeon to take better decision. They take snap inside and exclude all the submucosa there and add some internal flap that will allow them to have open mouth.
Right.
1 second, sir.
I'll make a last effort to show the movements of the tongue and.
Right.
1 second, sir. Direct video of camera.
If somebody wanted to know about any book where they can refer about.
I'm so sorry. When I started, I didn't have any references, to be frank. Yeah,
right. I think this is the most original work you have done, sir.
And of course, RSNA, it was read there. And in the recently book is coming, that is a textbook of maxillofacial surgeon, where a chapter on radiology for maxillofacial surgeon has come. That has been written by me and my colleague.
Right, sir. But, probably when that books come, everybody will at least in book information about the oral cavity and its pathologies.
properly. This is I was missing it.
Sir, videos, I think you will.
Okay. I'll play it the last when it's ready.
Okay. Sir, one more question has come about any size for the mesenteric hypertrophy. You had mentioned mesenteric hypertrophy as painless swelling.
There is no fixed size for a normal masseter assess. Luckily, we have got two masseters, compare the normal with the abnormal.
Right.
Bilateral masseteric hypertrophy, I have not heard. Unilateral masseteric hypertrophy, definitely you can. Because masseter thickness varies from age to onwards.
So
this is what I want to show the.
Yeah, I think it is associated with unequal chewing also. Because I remember long time I had done one thesis for a dental student who just measured the masseter thickness on either sides.
Correct.
And,
so in that case, in a particular case, you can definitely measure. And if there is a follow-up problem, you can keep on comparing that. But normal variation or what is the normal level is not, because age related. Just like, you know, if I say, what is the thickness of the hamstring? I have to compare it to the other thigh and then only see.
Yeah. So the other side we consider at normal,
which is
less, and the bigger one is hypertrophy. That way, I think we should take.
You can see the movements of those speckled
case.
And another case was there, and that is the tongue touch technique is more important.
That is good. I think that is your own innovation probably. One specific question has come, whether any specific precaution with respect to superficial temporal artery Doppler before the flap surgery. I'm not aware.
For all these flaps, the free flap surgeries, the donor area needs to have its blood supply, and there we do the Doppler study, not the recipient area. So we do Doppler study, especially free flap. We do tibia, fibula, in that case, peroneal arteries and the tibial arteries and the branches, anterior arteries and peripheral. Perforators, we make use of it, not the receiving area.
Okay, the donor area evaluation by Doppler.
This is all cases are done. This tongue touch technique, you can see there. See. We ask the patient to touch the area with his tongue, and beautifully you can see.
Sir, you need to share it again, I think.
You're
not seeing that.
Okay.
We are just seeing the video folders.
I'm sorry, it will come. Okay.
Yeah.
Can you see now?
Yeah. Now it's running.
You will thrill to see this.
Yeah. It is seen very nicely now.
All the layers are better seen. Not only that, symptomatic site can be touched by the tongue very easily.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Prashant.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for sharing your knowledge with us. I think this was fabulous. Right, so if any more questions they come, I'll just
I'll be here after Mrs. Bhatt's talk only.
Right. I think we will have another feast from Dr. Bhatt, madam. This, we come to the end of part one of today's session. And now we will go on to the another different area of application of ultrasound, high resolution ultrasound, I would say, in the skin lesions. Now, I request Dr. Kalpana Bhatt, madam, to put on video. Yeah, you are there.
Yes.
Dr. Kalpana Bhatt is a radiologist from Mumbai, and she has her own center of ultrasound biometry. And she, along with Dr. Deepak Bhatt, you must be knowing many people. He does exclusive eye ultrasound since almost 30 years or so. And we would like to listen from madam about applications of high resolution ultrasound in skin lesions. Thank you, madam, for sharing your knowledge with us.
Yeah, so I'll switch on the screen, can share.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's not coming on.
You have to open up the PPT, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah, it's open. Yeah. Am I on?
Just a minute.
Can you see it?
No, ma'am. It's not visible.
Okay. One second. Huh? Okay.
Yeah, ma'am. Now it's with. Yeah, yeah. You just have to open. Yeah, we can see the PPT, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So thank you. Yes. So let me take this opportunity to thank Dr. Prashant and also MSB IRIA to invite me to give this presentation on skin ultrasound. And before that, I would like to thank Dr. Joshi for his pearls of wisdom and a lovely lecture and presentation which he has taught us now, and of his idea of thinking out of the box. So one of the things that we are doing now is thinking out of the box, and we are doing skin ultrasound. Now, as we all know, the skin is a very superficial structure in the body. So we have to use probes which are higher in frequency and those probes are around 35 to 50 megahertz. And this technology of using those probes is called ultrasound biomicroscopy, because it gives us the resolution of a low power microscope. Now for that, and other thing what we have to do is using this also, plus skin only doesn't involve skin ultrasound. We also have to see the deeper structures like the subcutaneous tissue, the mucosa, the subcutaneous tissue, the muscle belly, because many of the skin lesions involve the deeper structures also. So not having only the ultrasound biomicroscopy, but we require the whole range from 2 megahertz to around 50 megahertz to give an ideal skin ultrasound scan and come to a nice final diagnosis. So coming back to the equipment that we see, what we use in my clinic is a very open probe, in which this is the probe which has the 35 and 50 megahertz, the probe is there, and we use these cups which have either saline or distilled water. We put it and then we keep the tip of the probe onto that, and then we scan. So the probes, which I've already said, we from 7 megahertz to 50, and sometimes we require up to 2 megahertz. So these I have just summarized what it is. From 2 to 15, we can see the subcutaneous tissue and the muscle. It gives us a resolution of 450 microns, and the depth of penetration is 40 to 100. But when we use the 35 megahertz probe and the 50 megahertz probe, what we get is 4 millimeters to 10 millimeters of depth penetration, and we get a resolution of 40 microns to 80 microns. In this 35, we can only see the skin and the superficial part of the subcutaneous tissue. When we go to the ultrasound, the 50 megahertz probe, we can see the epidermis and dermis and very, very little of the subcutaneous tissue. Now, this is very, very important to see. I will be showing you all in the other slides which I'll be showing. So now, what are the indications in which we are using and doing skin ultrasound? And also with skin, we also include the nail pathologies. So we use it for measuring the skin thickness, that is pre and post treatment. We do it for diagnosing chronic inflammatory disease and granulomatous disease like the scleroderma, morphia, in nail and skin psoriasis and deep fungal infections. Now, very important, it is also leprosy because it is part of the skin. So in that per se, we do not see the skin, we do not detect leprosy of skin by ultrasound, but we see the nerves. Now, in nerves, we have to see the thickness, if there is neuritis and if there is abscess. Again, the management for the patient varies on doing and differentiating these lesions. And if there is any associated pathology involving the nerves in a patient with Hansen's disease, we also use this technology to localize foreign bodies in the skin, in the nail, or any part of the body. We can use it for nail pathologies like tumors in retronychia and ingrowing nails. And a big thing what I've done now is for benign and malignant tumors of skin and nail tissue, where we can know the tissue of origin of the lesion, we can know the size and shape and the characteristics of the tumor, we can have the vascularity and the invasive depth. And last, in aesthetic dermatology, we can see for in polycystic ovarian disease if there is any complication related to acne, and also a rare complication of osteoma cutis, the case which I'll be showing now. And next is dermal fillers, which they are very commonly using in aesthetic dermatology. We can give the depth and placement, and even we can localize the dermal fillers. And if there is any complication like cellulitis, abscess, or thrombosis of a vessel, we can see by doing a skin ultrasound. Now, many a times when people have dermal fillers, they do not tell the radiologist or do not tell the dermatologist. So even to know up to 6 months, we in our country, we are using the temporary fillers. So we can also know the exact location, and if there are any fillers or not, that also we can tell the dermatologist. So accordingly, they can plan the therapy. Next is we can see the study the effects and efficacy of cosmetological agents, then of oils and interventions on the skin and scar. Again, I'll be showing you all the cases. Example, chemical peels, derma rollers, and creams for pigmentation or melasma of the skin, a study of which we have done. And the cream which was studied in my thing, it has also been is selling now in the market. And next we can see the study the scalp health, and we can also see the hair follicles which are there, and the cause of the alopecia we can come to know, because it's a very, very important part of aesthetic dermatology. So next, after that, we come to the normal anatomy of the skin. Now, this is the histopathology. Correspondingly, on ultrasound, we see a hyperechoic entrecho, which is the epidermis. Below that, we see the homogeneous hypoechoic as compared to epidermis. This is the dermis. In that, we can see traversing obliquely are the hair follicles. And below this is the subcutaneous tissue. Now, this is a scan done by 50 megahertz probe. So next we come to the lesions, the very common lesion, I mean, which I have been seeing in my clinic and which the dermatologist referred to me is scleroderma. It is an inflammatory condition of the skin in which abnormal collagen is deposited in the skin, and there is discoloration. And if it goes deeper, we can have a loss of thickness of the skin. It can involve the joints, muscles. So cosmetically, it looks very, very bad. So they advise skin to see the prognosis, and accordingly they can manage the therapy. So in that also we have morphia, which is very commonly seen in skin, which is a localized type of scleroderma, which is only to the skin. In that also we have a localized, generalized, linear, mixed, and pansclerotic type of morphia. So that is scleroderma of the skin. The deeper organs in this can be affected exactly below the skin. The other thing is we have systemic scleroderma. Again, there are points, like 17 point study which is done. So once they give treatment, they can assess whether the scleroderma is responding to the treatment or not, and whether it is improving. So next we come to the case in which there was linear morphia, which was involving the right shoulder and the arm. This is what the normal skin looks. We have the entrecho, that is the epidermis. We have the dermis. We have the dermocutaneous junction. And this is the subcutaneous tissue. And deeper to that is the muscle. So in next, can we see that there is increase in thickness of these plaques are there, which are erythematous. So here we see there is increase in thickness of the skin. The subcutaneous tissue is also showing some involvement in that the connective tissue inside the subcutaneous tissue is a little bit thickened. So here we can say little bit involvement of the subcutaneous tissue. The patient was a medical student. He was given therapy. Then he followed up with me after 3 months. We saw that we are seeing that there is a decrease in the thickness of the skin. Even the subcutaneous tissue equatexture is improved, and the fibers are being laid out in a nice fashion and in a normal fashion. So next we come to another case of linear morphia involving the face, in which the cheek and the mandible, the skin over the mandible was involved. There is a little bit of depression of the skin and the subcutaneous tissue here, with a little bit of disfigurement seen here. So the patient, here is the normal skin. Here we see the involved skin, in which there is increase in thickness. Then here in the same patient, we were seeing different pathologies of scleroderma, like that we were having here atrophic type of skin where the skin is decreased. So this patient went and got herself injected, and she did not tell me that there was she had injected fillers in there. But here we see that there are good fillers, and cosmetically it was looking very, very nice, and it was almost normal. Now fillers, they can put the fillers inside only when they are very, very sure that the lesion is dormant, it is not active, because then again, if it is active, then these fillers may act in a different manner and the purpose is not achieved. So this was a linear morphia case with dermal fillers. So next we come to psoriasis, in which we get shiny plaques on the skin, which are reddish erythematous. This is the histopathology. In the same thing we see on ultrasound, we see the entry echo, that the epidermis, which is thickened and hyperechoic. The subepidermal hypoechoic zone, which is there here, is thickened, which is showing that there is acanthosis. Now this is called hyperkeratosis because it is above. Below the skin, we see inside it is the acanthosis, and which is showing increase in thickness. And when we do post-therapy, we see that the hyperkeratosis and the acanthosis are decreased, which is showing the efficacy of the treatment and improvement in the lesion. So next, this patient presented with multiple reddish nodules on the skin, also below the eye. And he was already on antifungal. They had taken a biopsy, and a fungal infection, pheomycosis, was diagnosed. Then they want, after 9 months of therapy, they wanted to know whether these lesions which are there, the reddish nodules, and whether the fungal infection has decreased or not. This is the region of biopsy that they had done. So he came for an ultrasound to me. On doing ultrasound, we see that there is a very defined mixed echogenic lesion, which is around 2.5 in length and around 1.5 millimeters in thickness, which is localized to the dermis. Now this is the dermis, which is localized to the dermis. This is in a transverse scan. In the longitudinal scan, we see this. It's a granulomatous lesion, which we are seeing here. So he was continued on antifungal treatment for more 3 months. And post-treatment, we see that there is a improvement in the lesion, with almost a loss, with almost a healing of the granuloma, and it was looking almost normal. And then after 5 months, we again repeated the scan, and we saw that there was no granuloma, or there was no active lesion. So patient was stopped on antifungal therapy. So this is how ultrasound helped in diagnosing or in the therapy of a granulomatous fungal infection. So now this is another case in which this patient presented with a history of something migrating or something moving and around the eye. And she had a lot of irritation and itching in this region, in the lateral canthus of the eye, with a little bit of swelling there. On doing also, she was referred to our clinic. So on ultrasound, we saw that there was a worm, we saw this worm inside the dermis. This is the dermis, and there was some reaction or some hypoechoic area, which is probably the edema surrounding the worm, and it was very active or moving around. And so this is another scan which we saw of the worm which was there. So then the patient was operated on, and this is the photograph of the worm which he sent it to us. So next we come to a very important thing in dermatology is also Hansen's disease. So we get these borderline lesions, borderline tuberculoid lesions on the skin. When we do an ultrasound, we see that there is the entry echo is thickened of the epidermis. Below that, we have a subepidermal hypoechoic band, which is suggestive of inflammation in the subepidermal region. We see that the dermis is also thickened and it is showing an inhomogeneous echo texture. This is the hair follicle, which we see is thickened, and the patient also had alopecia in that region. So there is a perifollicular exudation or inflammation around the follicles. This is also another follicle, and here we see some zones which are the lymphatic increase in the lymphatic lymph or whatever the inflammation in the dermis. On post treatment, we see there is complete resolution or almost complete resolution of the subepidermal hypoechoic band, and even the edema and swelling in the dermis. Now next we come to the indications of ultrasound nerve in a Hansen's disease. When we see that there is enlargement which is generalized or localized, the patient is advised for doing a skin or nerve ultrasound. If they are suspecting neuritis, again the management changes because they will have to put in steroids or maybe a high dose of steroids. So they'll refer to us for doing a nerve ultrasound. If they are suspecting abscess, like there is a swelling, a lot of pain, tenderness, so again, they will come for an ultrasound. If they need to do intervention steroid, intralesional steroid injection, which some people, it's a controversial topic, or if they want to do a biopsy, we can do a nerve ultrasound. And to rule out pathologies of the nerve other than neuritis or a abscess. So for these conditions, they are referred to us for doing a nerve ultrasound in Hansen's disease. So just before going on to the lesions and how the nerves look on pathological nerve, let us just study the normal anatomy. Like this is how a nerve looks normally now. We all know how it looks. There's a honeycomb appearance of the nerve. This is the median nerve we are seeing here. And this is how it looks. These are the fascicles. This is the interfascicular connective tissue. And this is the whole nerve. And here we have the blood supply which of the nerve. So this is the normal anatomy. Then we go on to the pathological condition, that is nerve enlargement. Now this is the ulnar nerve at the elbow joint. So here we see a normal looking nerve, and here we see here we are having the dimensions. So here in obviously also there, this is enlarged, and it is having a little bit of inhomogeneous echo texture. Like it is not a normal echo texture of the nerve, but this is a case of just pure enlargement. When I followed the whole nerve, the ulnar nerve, how much your part we could see the anatomy, you can just go to the books, because it's this lecture is not for the anatomy. I mean, the course of the nerve, you can just see the course of the nerve followed up in the book and be aware of it. So in those areas, you can scan the nerve wherever it is superficial, and we can just see the whole nerve on ultrasound. It's a very, very good, because dynamically we can see the nerve and tell, pinpoint to them that exactly where an abscess or enlargement or thickening is there. So it is very, very useful to them to do a nerve ultrasound in Hansen's disease. So next we see a case of neuritis in which the whole nerve is enlarged. Then we were just seeing, and we are seeing, you know, there is edema inside, like it's looking more anechoic, all these nerve fascicles. And the dimensions are also very, very increased. So by this, we can say that it is neuritis. If you see a normal nerve or a thickened nerve, it will look in this with a normal, almost normal echo texture. But when you say it is neuritis, it will look more hypoechoic. The nerve fascicles also will look more hypoechoic as compared to the normal nerve. Not so in a nerve which is only thickened. See here, this is a very, I have enlarged the image. And we see that there is some increase in the vascularity surrounding the nerve. So this was a case of neuritis. So next we come to abscess in the nerve. So this patient came with history of Hansen's disease. He was already on treatment. And along the course of the ulnar nerve, there was thickening. So when I did the ultrasound, the nerve from the mid-arm region to up to the elbow was thickened, and it showed a very, very inhomogeneous echo texture. This is in longitudinal section. In transverse section, we see that the nerve fascicles are enlarged, and it is not anechoic like the neuritis one, but it is more hypoechoic. And sometimes, you know, only one of the nerve fascicles is enlarged, the other nerve fascicles may be normal. So again, we can tell them, so if suppose the surgery, they are going to go do any intervention, they can just tackle that nerve fiber and the whole other, the sensation of the nerve may be preserved, means, you know, the other sensations except for that fascicle which supplies a particular area, that may be anesthetized or that may be abnormal. So again, we have to tell them that this nerve and how much of the nerve is involved in an abscess or in any other condition, which will help them in the management of the lesion. Here we have just done Doppler and to show that there is increased vascularity. And when we came down, we saw that the nerve at the elbow was not that enlarged. I mean, there was no abscess in the region of the elbow. And this is the opposite nerve, which was normal. So doing a dynamic scan of the nerve is so very important so that we can pinpoint to them that the abscess is from the midarm to right up to the elbow and it is not going beyond the elbow. So this will again help them in the management. So very, very important means, as like in MRI and all that, we cannot do an a dynamic scan and we cannot do this way, you know. So in ultrasound, overspores with them in doing a dynamic scan and telling them, and plus it is very, very cost effective. Because leprosy, we have seen, and especially the neuritis, the novel type of leprosy we have seen, it's affecting more patients, whoever have been referred to me in the lower socioeconomic status. So telling them and going ahead with an ultrasound will reduce the cost for the patient and for his management. Okay, so next we come to nerve. Now this was another interesting case. In this, the patient was around 18-year-old male patient. Now he had past history of Hansen's disease. He was totally cured. And he went to the dermatologist, and while doing the palpation, by palpation they thought there is a mass lesion, and it was diagnosed as querineuroma. Now when they didn't even know that the patient had Hansen's disease, so when he came to me, I just went back and asked him the history. So he said that yes, he had Hansen's in the past. So when I scanned the patient, I saw that in a particular area, like in the midarm, now this is the brachial artery, in the midarm only, the nerve was thickened. It had an inhomogeneous equotexture and there was some calcification. So immediately our diagnosis changes. So instead of just neuroma of, neuroma giving a diagnosis, we can tell them that this is most probably residual to the past leprosy which he had had. So again, the management of the patient would change. So again, this is how it will help them. So next we come to another patient in which again, same history that she had Hansen's disease, and whether it was reactivation or whether there was an abscess, because she had obviously a swelling in the region just above the elbow joint. So when I did the ultrasound, I saw a mass lesion which was hyperechoic with multiple cystic areas within. So this was on transverse scan. When I saw the nerve in the region of the elbow joint, it was almost normal. So when I traced the whole nerve, I saw that just below the elbow, on the nerve, there was this mass lesion which was hyperechoic in ecotexture with multiple cystic areas. So again, our diagnosis changes to that it is an ancient schwannoma and not a nerve abscess. So again, this would help them in the management. So next, we come to tumors of the skin. So very common in the young age group are hemangiomas, lymphangiomas, vascular tumors. So this was a cherry red lesion. So they wanted to know the depth of the lesion, the amount of involvement. So again, they can whether it is a high vascular, low vascular, and whether it is not a hemangioma or is it an AV malformation. So when I did the ultrasound, we saw that the skin was thickened. The whole dermis was thickened. It was inhomogeneous in ecotexture. There were multiple linear anechoic areas, which were obviously capillaries. And on doing a high frequency ultrasound, I saw in the subcutaneous tissue, there was a well-defined hyperechoic mass lesion with anechoic linear areas within it. The underlying muscle was not involved. So on doing a Doppler study, we saw a high flow velocity in the lesion where we were seeing the anechoic areas. So then our diagnosis goes to an infantile hemangioma. So again, in this, they don't have to do anything. If you just wait and watch, it will regress. And by 6 years of to 7 years of age, the patient, the hemangioma regresses spontaneously. So no treatment is required. Only care that we have to tell the patient to do is to not have any traumatic lesion on this region, because if it bleeds, then it would be very, very difficult to stop it because it is a very, very high velocity flow lesion. So next we come to the different types of hemangiomas which we see on the skin. So now this was a cherry red lesions we have in all these patients. But when we do an ultrasound, we saw there are multiple cystic areas in the dermis. So our diagnosis goes to a cavernous hemangioma. When we see a homogeneous hypoechoic area in the dermis, we can tell that it is a capillary hemangioma. And when we do an ultrasound and we see this thin hypoechoic area in the subepidermal region, we can tell that it is a port wine strain. Now, to know importance of knowing that what type of hemangioma it is and the depth of the lesion, again, this is for treatment because when they give laser, if we give the depth of the laser, they can always direct the beam or the wavelength to such a length that it will not go beyond that. So it will not injure the deeper structures, and it can be localized, and the healing can be very, very good. Cosmetically very, very good. So next we come to another vascular tumor of the skin, which is a lymphangioma. Now we have multiple cystic areas on the skin or vesicles on the skin. So on doing a skin ultrasound, we see that there are well-defined hypoechoic to anechoic areas in the subepidermal region. And more for a lymphangioma, when the patient come to us, it is more for knowing the depth of the lesion. So when we do a high frequency ultrasound, we see that there is in the subcutaneous tissue is involved, the same patient, and there were multiple anechoic lesions of varying size in the patient, in the region of these vesicles, and also it was extending beyond it. So again, we can tell them the exact size and the depth and the thickness of the lesion. Now, this is just to show you all how a hemolymphangioma looks. We have inside it, we have echoes, which suggests that it is a hemolymphangioma. So next, we come to a lesion in which the patient presented with a lesion on the skin, which was freely mobile, and it was the overlying skin was pigmented. When we did an ultrasound, we saw that there is a well-defined hypoechoic to hyperechoic mass lesion with multiple hypoechoic areas in within it, hyperechoic areas. And if here we see that the lesion is it has a punctum, like it is going towards the dermis, and it is right epidermis, and it is touching the subcutaneous tissue, and it is also involving the dermis. So this is a sebaceous cyst or an epidermoid cyst. So we can tell them the exact size and the depth of the lesion. So again, the dermatologist knows how deep they have to go to remove this, to evacuate this lesion. So next we come to another lesion of the skin, which is there was a fixed papilla on the skin. On doing an ultrasound, a biomicroscopy, we saw that there was a well-defined hypoechoic mass lesion, which was around 1 centimeter in diameter. And the overlying epidermis was not well visualized, but only the papillary part, that is upper part of the dermis, was involved, but the lower part of the dermis, that is the reticular dermis and the subcutaneous tissue, were not involved. So this was a compound nevus, and the patient was operated, and now there is no lesion on the skin, and it was not recurrence. Yeah, this lesion was increasing in size, so that's why they sent to me for doing an ultrasound. So after that, we come out to another lesion which we see on the skin when the extensive acne treatment is given. So this patient had multiple papules, which are like comedon lesions. And on when they were trying to remove these comedons, it was a very hard and gritty feeling that the dermatologist was getting all these lesions. So they couldn't remove it. So they sent to me for ultrasound. So when we did a high frequency ultrasound, we saw curvilinear calcifications in the dermis. And the other part of the dermis was also inhomogeneous in texture. The skin was very, very irregular. Like this, we saw it's not a very straight skin. So again, it's because of the scar tissue and abnormal because of the acne, which was there in this patient. So when the lesion was extracted, there was a bone which came out. And the rest of the skin showed bone formation in this. This is the histopathology. So this was termed as ostium acutis. Now, it is not a very, very common complication of acne. It is a very rare. But when it is there, it is better to tackle it because then management of the lesion is very, very difficult for the acne and everything. And in this patient, she was operated. Then I did a follow-up ultrasound, which I don't have the follow-up pictures again. But she had multiple such other lesions which were small in size. So probably because of the ostium acutis is a bone formation in the skin, but it can be primary and it is also secondary. So here the secondary cause was inflammation of the skin. She had these multiple other things, but then those were not removed. So we are just following it up. Now it's almost 5 to 6 years since she was operated. And after 2 to 3 years, she comes for a follow-up ultrasound. So next we go on to tumors of the skin. Now squamous cell tumor. Now in that also, we have to know the depth of the lesion because as Dr. Joshi said, in squamous cell carcinomas, again, less than I think around 4 millimeters, he had said it is a good prognosis. And above that, you can correct me later on, above that it is, the prognosis also becomes bad. So this patient came with multiple 65-year-old male patient, we kept multiple plaques and scaly lesions on the skin. When we did ultrasound on some of these lesions, the lesion was just limited to the dermis. Like this, we see a very defined hypoechoic mass lesion, which was just in the dermis, the lower part in the epidermis. The dermis or the lower part of the dermis was not involved. So this they called as Bowen's tumor, which is a superficial type of squamous cell carcinoma. Then in the same patient, we had other lesions in which you see here the subepidermal region is involved. And we have a hypoechoic band, which is due to tumor infiltration of the subepidermal region or the upper part of the dermis. And here we see a small mass lesion, which is a nodule in the epidermis. So this was squamous cell carcinoma, whereas this is Bowen's tumor. The prognosis for this is good. If you see the prognosis as compared to this, it is bad. So again, he's lost to follow-up, but he was operated. So I cannot give you the follow-up scans post-treatment. Next, we come to another lesion in which the T-cell lymphoma affection of the skin, which is called as mycosis fungoides. Now in that, we have reddish color erythematous lesions or plaques on the skin. When we do an ultrasound, we see the epidermal entry echo is thickened and we have a subepidermal hypoechoic band. Now this is the infiltration of the abnormal T lymphocytes in this, which are cancerous. And the depth of this lesion to know is important because when they give treatment, post-treatment, we see whether there is decreasing or increase. They give UVA and UVB lights, they put them in a box and they make them sit and give that treatment. So post-treatment, after 3 months, we saw that there was a decrease in the size. So there was the treatment was effective. Then after that, the patient was lost to follow up with me. So I cannot give you a further scan of complete improvement of this lesion. So next we come to another interesting case in which this patient had a keloid-like lesion on the abdomen wall and he was operated twice in the past. Then he came with lesions on the skin which were keloid-like, but at the periphery there was these reddish nodules. So the dermatologist suspected a dermatofibrosarcoma protuberans because these keloid-type lesions were recurring again and again post-operatively also. So he came for an ultrasound to me. That was almost 7 to 8 years ago. So this is how the lesion looked. We had a, this is the dermis. We have this lesion here, which is hypoechoic in ecotexture. The margins of the lesion, this is an ultrasound biomicroscopy, both of them. The margins of the lesions were inhomogeneous and irregular. And here also we see that the lesion is hypoechoic, and we give the depth of the lesion and all doing. In this patients, we also need to do high frequency ultrasound so we can give the exact depth and the vascularity of the lesion. So here we see that it is going into the subcutaneous tissue. This is the tumor which is there, and the irregular margins and the exact the consistency or the appearance of the tumor we can tell them. And it was just limited to the subcutaneous tissue. So I gave the depth of the lesion and even the size of the lesion, the extent of the lesion. The patient was operated, and with multiple sessions, you know, like first the tumor was removed, then skin grafting was done. Now 7 years post-operatively, there is no recurrence of this dermatofibroma protuberans. And get in touch with this patient. He comes for follow-up even now. So next we come to the next thing is the nail. Now in the nail, this is the normal anatomy. This is the proximal nail fold. This is the proximal nail fold. This is the nail. We see. Then this is the matrix of the nail. And below that we see the nail bed. And this is the same in ultrasound. We see that this is the proximal nail fold. This part which you see in two lines which I have measured here, that is the nail, and below that is the nail bed. And if you can appreciate it, a thin hypoechoic line which is irregular like this, this is the matrix of the nail. Normal tumors of the nail generally arise from this region. So it's very important to see this region when we are doing a nail ultrasound. This is an ultrasound biomicroscopy image. And this is the cortex of the underlying distal phalanx. So same thing in the transverse scan. Here we see this is in the region of the proximal nail fold. We see the skin, that is the epidermis. This is the dermis. And this is the nail bed. And this is the bone, the cortex of the bone. So here the patient presented with a history of a soft tissue swelling, which was a little painful, and there was a hypopigmentation of the nail distal to it on a suspected glomus tumor. It was a suspected glomus tumor. On doing an ultrasound, we saw that there is a well-defined anechoic mass lesion in the proximal nail fold. So the diagnosis was made of a mucoid cyst in the proximal nail fold. So again, the management was easy. The depth we gave, the size we gave, and the patient was operated and he was symptom free. Now, this is another case in which the patient presented with a pinpoint tenderness in the proximal nail fold. And she used to give history of like cold sensitivity and hot sensitivity whenever she used to work. And even when anything used to touch, she used to get an electric sort of sensation in that region. So when she had undergone 2 MRIs to see the lesion, and she had done x-rays, but there was no diagnosis to it. So then they were referred to me. So now here we see a normal appearing nail of the adjacent thing. And then in the region of the nail, we see there is a well-defined hypoechoic mass lesion, which was around 350 microns by 400 microns, which was arising from the dermis of the proximal nail fold. It was causing a breach in continuity of the dermis, and it was protruding out. So I gave the exact location, like where she was getting the pinpoint tenderness, exactly there this mass lesion was there. So this patient was operated, and on histopathology, it was not a glomus tumor, but it was a neuroma. So next we come to another patient, same history, like she had a pain sensation, pinpoint tenderness in this region. an MRI was done, but it was negative. There was no lesion. When we did an ultrasound, we saw that there was an irregularity in the nail, in the proximal, the cortex of the distal phalanx underlying the nail. And you can just see, hyper or a mixed echogenic mass lesion. I've just measured it. Here we can see it in a transverse scan, which is causing scalloping of the underlying cortex. So she was operated, and it turned out to be a glomus tumor. So ultrasound biomicroscopy is very helpful in such dicey lesions. So we can pick it up, and again, once the patient is operated, she is very, very happy, she or he. So next we come to in cosmetology, we see a dermis where, if you can remember the normal appearance, we have a epidermis and we have the dermal the hypoechoic dermis. But when there is aging changes or there is pigmentation in the skin, we see a well-defined hypoechoic band, which is called a subepidermal hypoechoic band in this. So this is due to the aging of the skin. This is because of hyperplasia or the abnormal fashion in which the elastic tissue in the papillary dermis is done. So this is known as actinic elastosis. So we can take the depth of the lesion, we can measure it, and on if they, the patient applies a cream or these chemical peels, or if they do ultrasound on that part, that's a specific ultrasound for the skin. So this hypoechoic band decreases, and the overall appearance of the skin also improves. The patient also can see a visible, good appearing, a glowing skin. So this is like experimental, like we have done, like I have done a lot of researches with these chemicals, chemical peels, and these the tubes which are the creams which are available, and we have studied their efficacy, and the creams have also come out in the market. So that is where it helps. Then again, same thing. We did an experiment with a coconut oil in which we saw that the scalp, the subepidermal hypoechoic band showed a reduction, and the skin appearance, the scalp appearance was also very, very good. And the skin thickness also improved on applying that. Now in skin rejuvenation, like scars are there. This is how we see a dip. Like the scar, it was measured on the skin. You see a dip, and underlying the dermis was hyperechoic, which suggests that it is fibrotic, and there is fibrosis occurring there. So intralesional steroids were injected, and after 3 to 4 months, we saw, so there was good improvement. There was almost, the scar tissue was almost gone, and it was almost a normal, like adjacent normal appearing skin. So next we come to another thing in which the foreign body granulomas, which we can see in the skin. Now this was an 8-year-old female patient who gave history of glass breaking on her head. So, and then she was having some pricking sensation. So the dermatologist wanted to know what is there in below this pigmented lesion. So when we did an ultrasound, we saw a foreign body which was there, and around that there was a hypoechoic zone, and this was in the dermis. So this was a foreign body with a granuloma around it. The underlying subcutaneous tissue and the muscle and the bone were looking normal. This is also a UBM scan done on this patient. So next we come to when steroids, they are giving left, right, and center in dermatology. So here we see that this is the normal appearing skin, and here there is atrophy. So here the patient has to be taken off the steroids. So again, it can help us to know the efficacy or the disadvantage of using steroids on the skin. So after seeing this, the patient was discontinued from steroids. So recent advances in skin ultrasound, we have elastography to diagnose malignant tumors. Again, elastography, there is a paper on that. It can be used in diagnosing cicatrization alopecia, but I cannot show you any images because I am not doing elastography at this point. The other thing is OCT, which can be used in the skin and the nail. Now again, I'm not using, but it is a very good technique. which we can study all the layers of the epidermis and the dermis. The epidermis we cannot see on ultrasound biomicroscopy very, very well. So that thing can be done with an ultrasound, an ocular coherence tomography. Then there is 1 gigahertz ultrasound probe in which we can only visualize the epidermis and its pathologies. And the Doppler, which is in, I mean, I don't know whether it is there or not, but we can think of, they can think of doing a Doppler on a 50 megahertz probe. Again, that will help us in differentiating these linear echoes, which we get in the skin, whether they are lymphangiomas or vascular or any other pathology. So take home message after doing a skin ultrasound, we can say that it is a non-invasive in situ objective tool for diagnosis and prognosis in general and aesthetic dermatology. There is very good patient compliances multiple areas can be scanned, so we can minimize skin biopsies. So it can ultimately improve the diagnosis and hence the prognosis of the disease. But the only disadvantage that we get out of doing an ultrasound is we cannot get a tissue or the histopathological diagnosis. So sometimes they have to do a biopsy, and many a times they have to do a biopsy. So with this, we end the slide. Thank you very much for being with us. It was good to interact with all of y'all. And I hope it is beneficial to y'all to think of the out of the box and start doing skin ultrasound in your regular practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for the beautiful demonstration of various skin pathologies. And I think most of us have seen them for the first time. And some superficial lesions we are seeing, like you have shown lymphangioma or hemangiomas or heavy malformations. But seeing dermis and epidermis must be really exciting.
Yeah, very.
And it gives like a histological picture.
Yeah.
So it's very nice. A few questions have come up. I'll just read out. Do these probes have elastography? I think you answered in the last slide.
Yeah.
It is just coming up things.
Yeah.
One more question is any specific ultrasound findings for melanotic melanoma?
Yeah, in melanoma, I'm sorry because time was running short, but then we get a hypoechoic mass lesion in the dermis and the epidermis. Sometimes, you know, with these high frequency probes, because they are pigmented lesions, so it may not penetrate. So we have to go to a high frequency rather than an ultrasound biomicroscopy. We have to do a high frequency ultrasound. So that can be seen, and we see a hypoechoic mass. I don't have it now, but I have done, and it is already in the public domain. We have an article on skin ultrasound in Indian Journal of Dermatology. I think it's 2007. It was published, and it was awarded also as the best article for that year. So y'all can just go back and see those images and read up on that.
Right. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
One more question. Can USG biomicroscopy help in diagnosing facial disnification and fibrosis?
Yeah, of course it can. In scleroderma, we do tell them that there is fibrosis. Like, see, the stages of scleroderma, first is edematous stage. Then we get a stage which is sclerosis. Like, you know, it is also going to the subcutaneous tissue, and then after that it's atrophy. So when the ecotexture of the dermis changes, it becomes more hyperechoic as compared to the normal dermis. We can say that the fibrosis is setting in, and also we will find a decrease in thickness, or in scleroderma we may find an increase in thickness with lots of the subcutaneous tissue under it. So we can say that the fibrosis is setting in and it's going towards atrophy. Like, there is worsening of the lesion.
Right. Thank you. I think you have shown that in your slides also.
Yes, I have shown it. Right.
One more question is about, do you use standoff pads? Particularly when you use a regular high frequency probe.
I'm using this the cup which I had shown. We put saline or distilled water, and then I put the probe, it has to be immersed in the water because it is an open crystal probe. So we cannot place it directly. So we can put a gel also, but with gel, I'm not finding it so good. So I put normal saline or distilled water and do it.
Okay. And for our routine ultrasound probe, that's
I do put a lot of gel, you know, because gel helps us to scan those areas.
Okay, because nowadays the linear probes are coming with more and more resolution, more number of crystals.
Yeah, but it will. I've seen those, but they don't give us the resolution of 35 and 50.
Like definitely.
Yeah.
The basic frequency will be around 10, and in the UVM it will be 35. It's not a difference.
Yeah,
not it's like seeing abdomen with convex probe and a linear
probe. Yes, absolutely correct.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just checking if any new question has come. One question for sir has come.
I'm here.
So what should be the minimum frequency for probe for optimum cheek and skin evaluation?
Minimum five is better.
Yeah,
five which has got an extension further, not 3 to 5.
Yeah. Okay, 5-10 or 5-12, like I think.
Ideally is I say 10-12 is very good.
Okay.
So, 10-12 is very good.
Yeah, nowadays I think machines have got probes up to 16 or 18 also.
Yes,
for MSK purpose they are using. I think they are also good. One question from my side, not question from just a suggestion from my side to ma'am. What message you would give to the younger generation regarding skin ultrasound? Because it's totally different thing as I have seen. I also seen for the first time. But it's a totally different thing, and I think it is useful also.
Yeah.
What would message you would give to all?
Like if you have the facility to invest in a probe, I mean to invest in this machine, go ahead and buy it. Maybe if it's a big institute, they can afford it. So start doing and let the dermatologists know that they are having something which, you know, they can reduce the biopsy and the interventions, you know. It is also very, very helpful to them. So, and plus in the nerves, you know, one can start doing nerves in Hansen's disease, but because there is dearth of sonologists who are doing nerve ultrasound for Hansen's disease. So that the dermatologist keeps complaining because they are also like people not only in Bombay can assess, but which are in other places, they can start doing nerve ultrasound, you know, which will be very, very helpful to, because it's a normal, a regular frequency probes which we are using. So at least in areas which you have, you please start doing. So it will help out in them, for them and for treating the patient in general. And they will also know that, okay, they can depend on us. We have some other area, you know, some other source of income in doing that way.
That is what the next question has come. What is the cost of the machine?
The cost of the machine is high. Like it is almost like 40 to 50 lakhs. Only the 35 and 50 megahertz probe machine. That's on biomedical.
Huge investment.
Huge investment.
This is the major concern about the cost of the high frequency probe.
Yeah.
Especially what they said is skin, whatever that you use. You should get that much more reference at least for you to survive.
Yeah, very true, very true.
And keeping that title without getting reference becomes very difficult. So, madam has done excellent talk and create the awareness. The awareness should go to all the dermatologists who has to refer.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Then naturally, a radiologist can take
then,
it up.
You know, we should start doing taking, because now dermatologists are taking those machines. Like we have in one in Bangalore. Christian Medical College, after seeing me, and another one in Kerala. So after seeing me and my presentation in a dermatological conference, they went ahead and bought the machine and they've started doing. So they are using all of us. So it is good if some of you all buy it, start doing it, you know, so at least they will not impinge on our field and we can get another, you know, area of doing ultrasound. Gynecologists have already come into ultrasound. So now dermatologist will also come. So start doing it.
Right, madam. One question has come. I think you have already answered. That is very what good is the meaning.
It was very informative.
Yeah.
And yes, I doubt how many radiologists will take it up, mainly because of, as I said, you know,
yeah,
whatever senior, at least you should take for minimum.
Yeah.
But it's a very good talk.
I think we have lost. Talk
and highly informative.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, madam and sir, for your cooperation and giving us sharing the knowledge with us.
Thank you.
With this, we end today's session and we would come back with a new session next weekend. Thank you all for joining us.
Amit.
Yeah, thanks, Amit, for the, I think.